Good evening, everyone, and thanks for joining us for the Schar School Law and Policy Panel, Corporate Profit or Public Good, Prison Privatization and the Question of Justice. My name is May Kadal, and I'm a Government and International Politics major in the Schar School, and I'm also an undergraduate student liaison. The job of student liaison is to help both prospective students and current undergraduate within the Schar School to become more familiar with different programs and all the aspects that the Schar School has to offer. We are so excited for your interest in the Schar School of Policy and Government. For the next 30 minutes or so, you will hear from several members of the Schar School community. At the end of the panel, we will provide some information about the application process, followed by a question and answer period with our panelists. We look forward to hearing from you. If you have questions throughout the session, you can submit them using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Our presenters may respond in the Q&A to some questions throughout the session, so keep an eye on that if you want to see what others are asking. We will also answer questions live at the end of the presentations. One thing we would love to hear about in the chat is where you're from and what you might be interested in studying in college. Now, let me introduce you who you will be meeting today. Shanna Williams is the Director of Student Services at the Schar School. Jim Burroughs will be your moderator tonight. He came to the Schar School after spending the first part of his career in law and government and now teaches in the public administration program. Siona Listokin is a professor who specializes in business, corporate finance, and corporate social responsibility and public policy. Chris Burke is a professor specializing in the politics of punishment and penal law. Philip Mink is a professor and director of the Patriot Pre-Law Program. Liam Timmons, a graduate of the Schar School who is currently at Yale Law School working towards his JD. Now let me welcome you, Shannon Williams from the Schar School Student Service Team.
Thank you so much, May. It's lovely to have you here and it's great to see everybody. All of us here at the Schar School have been working harder than ever to provide high quality degree programs in fields of study that are now more relevant than ever. So the Schar School offers two undergraduate degrees, and I'm just going to give you a quick overview of what they are before we start the panel. The Bachelor of Arts in Government and International Politics is the traditional political science and international relations program. The program has over 800 students. The professional interests of our BA students include law and diplomacy, foreign service, federal government service, international security, political campaigns, and working on Capitol Hill. The Bachelor of Science in Public Administration prepares students to work in public service, which is really the business of Washington. So this program has over 100 dedicated students in it, and this degree is great for those who are interested in nonprofits, human resources, advocacy, public policy, federal government service, state and local government as well. The BS focuses more on the logistics of government on all levels, and it includes a bit more policy analysis and economics. So in both programs, you will have access to many avenues for taking your classroom experience to the next level. I will provide more information, like May said, on the application process at the end of the panel. So for now, I'm going to go ahead and hand things over to Jim Burroughs, who's going to be the moderator of tonight's panel. Jim, you're actually muted. If you want to go ahead and unmute yourself, that would be great.
My apologies to everyone. Okay. I was so excited to start talking. First of all, thank you all for taking time out of your day. And my apologies for not miking up on time. I'm going to spend the bulk of my time today talking about public administration and public policy issues, especially in the area of privatization and particularly the privatization of prison services. I'm happy to answer any specific questions you have during Q&A that you might have about our degree programs or other opportunities. Tonight's going to show how different public policies develop, how they evolve, and then how they merge. In the 1970s, our country faced tremendous economic challenges for which much of the blame was placed on government. One response from President Carter was to support deregulation of a number of major industries, including aviation, rail, and the trucking industries. With the election of President Reagan in 1980, the deregulation movement combined with what many economists said the country needed to do, which was to privatize a great many functions that the government had been doing. the private sector was believed to be more open to new ideas than government, and that market forces could provide services cheaper and more efficiently. President Clinton continued this with his Reinventing Government movement, which incorporated many market-based approaches to governance. The privatization movement was not limited to America, but took hold in Britain, Australia, and New Zealand, among other countries. Over the last 40 years, we've seen a fundamental change in how public services are provided. All the states and the federal government have contracted out or privatized many functions. There are global corporations operating public utility systems and toll roads worldwide. Today, there are five contractors doing government work for every federal civil service employee. Since the 1990s, much of justice policy debate has focused on drug problems and drug-related violence, beginning with a crack cocaine epidemic of the late 80s and early 90s. Nationwide, legislatures passed stricter punishments, such as the three strikes and you're out laws. As a result, prison populations have risen from about 1 million in 1990 to over 2 million today. These new policies created demand for more prisons and more prison cells. One significant part of the global privatization movement is the rise of the private prison. There are private prisons in many countries and across the United States. Private prisons are a multi-billion dollar industry in the United States. Many segments of our justice system are now managed by private contractors, including building, managing, and staffing prisons to parole, probation, and counseling services. Most of the historic debate about private prisons has been based on the claimed cost-effectiveness of private prisons over public prisons. After almost 40 years, the best answer to the cost question is that it's not clear. After many independent university studies and U.S. Department of Justice reports have shown no clear advantage for private prisons in terms of cost. There are two problems with this historical focus on cost-based private prisons versus public. The problems are corruption and distortion of the justice system. There have been a number of well-known examples where government officials were bribed by private prison operators. The best known of this is the Pennsylvania Cash for Kids scandal, where thousands of juveniles were convicted for minor mistakes as judges were paid to keep private juvenile facilities full. In other cases, government officials have been bribed to steer contracts towards certain private vendors, including at one state, the state prison director was bribed. Private prison companies spend millions of dollars per year lobbying elected officials. And even without the concept of bribery, political campaigns are supported by private prison owners who get access to the legislators and even submit legislative proposals to increase sentences and to limit parole. This vast contracting out of government functions has been labeled the new spoils system, where lobbying, contributions, and access have replaced the old 19th century political party-based spoils system. In terms of distortion of justice, private prisons negotiate contracts to get paid whether the prison cells are used or not. It's a growing body of evidence which suggests that the presence of private prisons may lead to longer sentences and higher incarceration rates in some states. Again, research is showing that cost savings are found in reducing rehabilitation services normally provided in public prisons, and that prisons are evolving more into human warehouses. Likewise, cost reductions are found in smaller staff levels at private prisons, making prisons dangerous places often controlled by inmate gangs. Lastly, the privatization of prisons reduces democratic transparency and accountability. The contract process means that appointed and elected officials are not directly responsible for prison conditions. A public prison warden can be called to account. As a public employee, prison records may be subject to a Freedom of Information Act requests. The contracting out process puts prison operations beyond most public accountability measures. Okay, now let me turn this talk over to Professor Chris Burk.
Thanks, Jim. I want to start with just a really simple observation. And that's that description and policy prescription are really intimately tied together. So, you know, how we describe an issue is intimately related to the kinds of solutions or responses that we're going to see as appropriate. So, you know, when we describe something, certain features are going to become more visible, and then others are going to fall into the background. So under one description, private prisons aren't all that worrying. So if I were to take an informal survey of you all here and ask, well, what percentage of the 1.5 million people in prison, not including the 750,000 in jail, are in private prison beds? I expect a lot of you would give me answers that about, you know, half of all prisoners or all the way up to 80 or 90%. Now, the actual number in private prisons is actually far less than that. It's about 10%. And while that number is a big change from the late 1970s, the pace of private prison growth over the last few decades has roughly paced the growth of the prison system as a whole, which includes, most recently a decline. So we have about 111,000 people in private prison beds. So to be clear, that's not a number that we should scoff at. That's a lot of people. But the general point is that mass incarceration in the US is largely and predominantly an issue of public prisons. So using this description, perhaps private prisons aren't all that worrying. But you might say then, fine, Chris, well, private prisons don't constitute a particularly large share of all prisons, but we should describe the problem a bit differently. The issue is not simply or merely private prisons, but the phenomena of privatization. So after all, there are prisons and jails that are run by government agencies, but where almost every single service in that facility has been outsourced or privatized. Telephone services, video calling services, tablets, money transfers, laundry services, community corrections. Think about electronic home monitoring. People have to pay to actually have monitors on their ankles. So food, commissary, if you walk anywhere inside of a jail or prison, you're going to see private actors. So I think this description gets us closer. So let's take an example. Take the example of food. And consider the situation of a single company, Aramark, that provides in some prisons both basic food and supplies for commissary items. So commissary items, to be clear, are things like vending machines or supplementary food. And so what happens is it creates this perverse incentive. You have the same company as providing food that also benefits from vending machines. So if you make the food terrible, you're going to drive up demand for your commissary items. But again, while this is upsetting, I'm not sure this is a simple feature of privatization. So we have parallel examples in public jails, for example, where an Alabama sheriff was able to redirect $750,000 a year that was allocated to feeding prisoners as a part of a federal contract provision that allows him to keep any funds that were unspent at the jail. But what's particularly damning, as I see it, is how public and private forces interact in the context of prisons. So that is, the government's not separate from all of these abuses. They're a collaborator and a conspirator with private companies, and also profit just like the corporations themselves. So give another example. You have telecom giants that are going to charge over $1 a minute to video chat, for individuals to video chat with loved ones. The government then turns to this Orwellian language of video visitation as a way to eliminate actual in-person visits for prisoners. And to add insult to injury, you know, imagine that one of your loved ones is behind bars and you're receiving marketing emails from that same company with subjects like, you haven't called your loved one in a while, they're missing you. What's disgusting about these examples and a slew of others, which I, you know, could point out, but only have my small amount of time here, it is not just the presence of a profit motive, is that you have a situation in which you have various groups, public and private, that are allowed to contract together when it's not a competitive process of negotiation and without any direct accountability. So to be blunt, what it is that you have these partnerships that are really just a partnership to exploit the community that they're actually supposed to be serving. There's a layer of intolerable corruption and abuse that serves as a block to other rational reform efforts. It's not going to sort of solve all issues with mass incarceration, but this layer of corruption is absolutely damning for attempts for reasonable and rational prison reform efforts. And so with that, I've already stretched my time a bit, and I want to turn the conversation over to my colleague, Siona.
Okay, thanks, Chris. So I'm actually going to take a 30,000 foot view. We're going to take a step back, and we're having this conversation about prison privatization, but But of course, this is part of a larger policy question about incarceration policy, right? And so I want to just give a little bit of an overview of how policy might approach incarceration, and we'll get to this privatization. You know, if you think about it, we'll take an example of a nonviolent crime, but had the potential to accelerate to something worse. So think about a home burglary, right? Now, should we incarcerate someone who has been found guilty of that crime, and for how long? And if you think about this from an economic policy point of view, you might set up a cost-benefit analysis, right? So I want everyone to kind of set a ledger in front of them with costs and benefits of incarcerating this individual, right? Feel free to add it in the chat. But if you think about the costs, oftentimes with policy, costs are a lot more tangible, they come up faster, and they're easier to quantify and monetize, right? So on the cost section, you might think, well, we've got to house and board this individual, right? We have to feed them, we have to guard them. The heat has to be on, or the air conditioning, preferably, right, in certain climates. And there are those kind of immediate and obvious costs. Now notice that economics traditionally would kind of wave their hands about the actual administration and management of those tasks, right? Because the assumption is that however they're being done, whoever is actually doing the administration of the room and board, they're doing it efficiently. Right? But sticking with that cost-benefit analysis, there are other non-tangible or less obvious costs, right? You can think about there's an opportunity cost to incarcerating someone, to limiting someone's physical liberty, right? There are costs to a community and costs to this individual's family, right? Now, on the benefit side, right? Again, think for a second about what are the benefits to incarcerating someone who has been found guilty of this activity. And you know, here, as with many other policies, the benefits are very intangible and really hard to place a value on. So one benefit of incarceration might be that you're preventing other crimes, either by this person or by more probably other people, right, who see that there's an actual punishment and you prevent other crimes of this nature. And that's the real benefit, right? There's elements of justice here, but truly we're trying to prevent crime. Now, when we get to the question of privatization, that's a question of organization and efficiency, right? Presumably we've made a decision about whom and for how long we should incarcerate, right? And now we have to manage that. As Jim and Chris noted, right, there are different incentives when you think about public versus private management schemes of any public service, right? I mean, most typically when you move to privatization, you're thinking about having a lot more flexibility with labor costs, right? If the prison population goes up, you can hire people. And guess what? If the prison population goes down in the private prison, it's easier to fire people, which you might not have that flexibility in the public sector, right? And so you have to approach this not just from economics, but also from a management and organizational development point of view. Now, Jim and Chris also brought up ideas of political science, right? There are going to be different special interests that come into play, not necessarily corrupt, but potentially corrupt, anytime that you have powerful public monies being spent. Right, and that's going to be true whether we're talking about public administration or private administration. So you need to figure out what those incentives are and where the transparency is. I'm going to add one more discipline here. So we've got economics, we had organizational behavior, we had political science, and I'll add sociology and legitimacy theory, right, where when we're talking about criminal justice and the physical limitation of liberty, we need to have not just transparency that we've talked about, but legitimacy, right? And so we can focus on short-term and intermediate-term costs and benefits of different management structures, but we need this system to have legitimacy in a community in the long term. And so we might actually end up sacrificing some efficiency in some cases in order to preserve that long-term legitimacy. Right. So if you can throw in another discipline, I think we're going to throw in law, of course, now. So I'll stop here and turn it over to Phil.
Thank you so much. It's a pleasure to be here with all the panelists and all the attendees. I would just comment briefly on the sorts of corruption that Chris was talking about and Jim was talking about. What most often happens in the real world is, you know, you don't have lawyers who are in it for the money to do that sort of thing, to file the lawsuits that will correct that problem. So they're often filed by public interest lawyers, and I'll get to them in a minute. But first, you should know that if you do want to go into the law and get involved in addressing these types of problems beyond getting your BA or BS, the Schar School is just a terrific place to be. We have a lot of legal content in our courses. We have several really terrific professors, Professor Burroughs, Professor Berk, Laura Walker is another great professor. They can really help you prepare for the law if you want to pursue that route to changing the world in the way you would like to see it changed. The reason I'm here today, though, is to tell you that if you do pursue that route, you're facing a very different outcome sometimes than what you would face if you go into private practice. If you go into a typical law firm, a private practice, some DUI walks in the door, if they're willing to pay the money, you'll take the case. If it's a wills and estates case, you'll take the money and take the case. It's very different from seeing horrendous conditions, and I'm from the state of Mississippi, which has some of the worst conditions, prison conditions you can imagine. And you want to file a lawsuit, usually under some constitutional provision, a line of cases that will allow a lawsuit. You don't make a lot of money at that, mainly because your clients are prisoners. They may have families that can help, but often they don't. Very high percentage of African Americans in Mississippi prisons and other southern prisons. So you're counting on nonprofit organizations. I regularly donate to a place called the Mississippi Center for Justice. One of my good friends from college, two good friends actually from college, are lawyers with that group. What they did, one of them went to Harvard Law School. He could have worked anywhere in the world. He chose this small civil rights firm in Mississippi because he wanted to bring lawsuits on behalf of individuals who are trapped in these terrible prison conditions. The problem with pursuing a career like that is you're going to make probably less than half of what you would make as a private practice lawyer, which the private practice attorneys make well over $100,000 a year. A typical public interest lawyer may make $50,000 a year. I'm not saying that should be a factor in your consideration necessarily. I had to put two kids through college. Many of us have that issue in our lives. So you do need to be aware when you're selecting a career and selecting a path in life. Prepare for the practical outcomes as well. I have immense respect for people who choose these sorts of careers and these sorts of policy-directed career choices. Just be aware when you come to Schar, if you start school, if you want to start in pre-law, be aware of all the possible outcomes you can face, and we can help you get there one way or the other. Thanks very much. And I will now turn it over to our brilliant student, Leanne Timmons, who's now at Yale Law School.
Yeah, great. Thanks so much, Professor Mink. Like May pointed out and Professor Mink just mentioned, I graduated from the Schar School with my degree in government and international politics this past spring. I'm in my first semester pursuing my JD at Yale Law School. And tonight I just want to kind of connect the topic of the panel and the practical considerations that Professor Mink brought up with the offerings that the Schar School provides for its students in terms of law and policy related activities. And I really do think that attending the Schar School and attending Mason really put me on the right track from my law school career and hopefully my legal aspirations. It's an overview of some of the things I did undergrad research through the Schar School, both with professors and independently. They provided tons and tons of financial and academic support for that, access to internships. I did two internships in DC, one with the UN in New York City over the summers, and having that proximity to the nation's capital as well, just the ability to go to events at the Schar grad program in Arlington or you know, various NGOs and governmental institutions in DC itself has also been super valuable. Like Professor Mink said, some of the law, philosophy, policy related courses at the Schar School, there is a wide variety of those. I know people have taken constitutional law. I took philosophy of law and some logic related classes personally. And then, you know, plenty of policy offerings as well. And then the last thing I wanted to highlight was policy-oriented extracurricular activities, stuff like the Roosevelt Institute or some things I've done through the Honors College were really helpful in allowing me to explore my own policy interests. And I think the main takeaways the Schar School really did provide me with the research, writing, academic, and also personal skills necessary for me to succeed both in school and at the next level at Yale. So if you're considering law school, if you're considering a degree in political science or career interests in policy, I do really think that the Schar School and Mason generally will help you achieve those goals. And if you know people have any questions about what I did or my path, I'm more than happy to answer those as well.
Great, thank you all so much. And Liam, that was a wonderful segue into my little pitch that I'm gonna give right now about the application process. So I know that we don't have any questions in the Q&A yet, but we do have some attendees on this panel who I'm sure are thinking about what's being said. So if you have, this is your moment to take a second to come up with a question, go ahead and put it in the Q&A. It's totally fine if your question is not completely polished or well-formed. This is an opportunity to have a conversation with some Schar School professors. So we'd love to hear from you in the Q&A. You can also introduce yourself in the chat if you would like. So I'm just gonna take a minute and give you a little bit more information about the Schar School application process, the Mason application process. You're getting a sort of a topical introduction to policy and law through the lens of the privatization of prisons. But of course, there's so many other things to explore at the Schar School and at Mason. So let me just tell you what the next steps are if you are interested in applying. For freshman applicants, so if you're currently high school junior or senior, you have two online application options. First, there's the common application or the Mason exclusive application. And admissions does not give preference to one version or the other. You can use either application to apply to Mason. So the application deadline for early action, non-binding, is coming up really soon. That's on November 1st. So if you're working on your applications now, you can go ahead and get that in. For regular decision, the deadline is January 15th. We also encourage all students to file the free application for federal student aid, which is also known as FAFSA, by January 15th. So that application opened on October 1st, and you can find out about that at FAFSA.gov. So you can find out more information about the process and required freshman application materials on the Mason admissions website. There's a nice long URL on the bottom of the slide, but you can just Google Mason admissions and learn more about that process. So for those students that are interested in transferring, you may be a Nova student or from some other college and thinking about transferring to Mason. So for regular and transfer applicants, there's the Mason exclusive online application. So that deadline is March 1st, and as with freshmen, we encourage you to go ahead and file the free application for federal student aid, FAFSA. And again, that application opened up on October 1st. So there is a transfer pathways, there's guidance on the Mason website and the required application materials. You can find all of that on the admissions website, again, at the URL at the bottom. You can contact us or contact Mason to find out more. So as our panelists have just given you a quick introduction to some of these topics, and here's a list of the panelists that are here tonight, you are welcome to direct a question directly at a panelist or at the whole group. You can ask a question of the current student, May, or of Liam, who is a recent graduate of our program. So we're eager for your questions, but in the meantime, there's sure a lot more of this topic that we can cover. So I'm gonna go ahead and hand it back to Jim right now to see where we're gonna take it next. Thanks.
Thank you, Shannon. We're welcome any questions that you have. We do want to answer them if they're closely related to this topic or if they're just topics about things like pre-law or suggestions about what you can study when you're at Mason. We're glad to answer those. I don't see any questions at the moment, so I'm going to start with a question to Professor Burk. I get the impression in terms of your analysis and the work that you've done on prisons that in most ways, public and private prisons are more alike than they're different. And we're just highlighting the differences tonight. And what do you see as sort of the overall problems with the public and private prison system in the United States?
It's not that there's sort of no difference between them, but there are sort of pathologies that are shared. So, for example, people will often point out sort of occupancy requirements for private prisons, that there are many cases embedded in these contracts that state governments will make with contractors like Core Civic, which is the name of the conglomerate that used to be CCA, one of the early private prison companies, is that, you have to have a 97% occupancy rate. And if you sort of fail to get that occupancy rate, the state will pay a fine. But the You know, the contracts for public prisons often have similar kinds of contracts around staffing. So the sort of paying as Siona pointed out, it's much harder to sort of fire someone, but so there's sort of staffing requirements in the public sector embedded in some of the some of these contracts that functionally work the same way. That while it's not about beds, it's about requirements to keep staffing or sort of keep costs high and so on. And you could sort of go down the list, whether it's lobbying, whether it's occupancy contracts, whether it's sort of accountability mechanisms. Profiteering. Private prisons, they represent a sort of new venue in which a lot of these pathologies can sort of grow in ways that we should be attentive to. And so I guess the point that I was trying to make in my comments is that we need to disaggregate and twist the problem a little bit, is that it's not the mere fact that there's a profit motive or the mere fact that something is private. There are a lot of these forces that are sort of at work that lead to profiteering with government and private collaboration in some cases. And we should be sort of calling out these abuses for what they are.
Great, thank you. Let's ask another question I'll put out to the panel. Perhaps Professor Listokin. We're in another recession. We don't know how long it will last, but certainly we know that a dozen years ago we were in the Great Recession. There are many states that are very, very hard up, and a number of states that have sort of teetered on the edge of bankruptcy. Their bonds have gone into junk bond status. What do we expect from states who are cash strapped? Are they more likely to go into privatization and take some immediate advantage of available cash from some of these private organizations?
So I think first we should note that for state and local governments, typically, after the Great Recession, their recovery was incredibly slow, right? So the stimulus wasn't enough in 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011. And so states were still laying off public service, public employees a good 3-4 years after the financial crisis. And that probably really held back the economic recovery in the country as a whole. Now, I think it's an empirical question that frankly I'm not sure of, but my understanding is that there wasn't, you know, a rush into prison privatization following the Great Recession. And Chris, I don't know if that's right. And that, you know, where there's a rush in a time when states are really cash strapped is where you can actually sell an asset, right? And that potentially isn't the case here. What you're doing is transferring the contract. So I don't know if empirically we saw more of a move towards private prisons following 2008, but that would probably be a good model.
Okay, next I want to follow up on something Professor Mink opened up on. For people who can't afford a lawyer, we do know that in criminal law, the government's required to provide a lawyer, and there are certainly public defender offices, and then there's appointed counsel in some state. But Professor Mink, we've got a problem because there is no readily available public aid for impoverished people who need private legal, civil legal services. And you mentioned certainly civil rights cases, but how bad is that need across the board for legal services for poor people?
Oh, I think it's just absolutely terrible. If you think about it, a lot of people, if you go to law school, you fill out your FAFSA form, you could well easily spend $150,000 beyond what you've already spent on your undergraduate schooling. So it's a big problem when you graduate from law school to pay down your debt, unless you're lucky enough to have someone who will pay it for you. And that's from what I've seen in 15 years, it's very seldom does that happen. So I think law graduates are under tremendous pressure to make money. A lot of students will say, well, I'm going to go into corporate law and do that for a few years and then do what I want to do. But it becomes very difficult to change that pattern. Once you get in, you start making money, you have a mortgage again, you have the kids, they want to go to college. So I think you really have to think this through carefully. If you join something like one of these public interest firms that do bring the lawsuits, they're all too rare, unfortunately. I was talking before with the panelists about Curtis Flowers in Mississippi. He was held in prison for 20 years. He was tried 6 times. The prosecutor couldn't get him, couldn't get a conviction. And it went all the way to the U.S. Supreme Court, and the court went back, threw it back down because he was clearly discriminating based on race in the selection of jurors. Were it not for people like my friend from college, who is willing to make $50,000 a year when he could be making so many more times, multiples of that, these people would not have representation. And I think, you know, it's a really difficult conundrum we face. I wish we had more government funding for that. But that's where we are. Right now, our legal system is just not geared to helping individuals who really, really need that help.
Thanks. Let's do a 2020 question. We've had a lot of incidences with police brutality. Mm-hmm. Obviously, the George Floyd and Breonna Taylor incidents, a lot of protests, Black Lives Matter. What is the response here in terms of both the legitimate protests and then the violent protests that we've seen? What kind of political action do we expect? Do we expect that there will be more arrests, or will there be more tolerance? And what is this likely to mean for incarceration rates in public and private prisons? And I'll throw that out to anyone on the panel who wants to sort of take a shot at that.
Maybe I can give the first sort of cut at it. One of the things that we're seeing now is increased attention to issues around not just policing, but sort of the wider issues of mass incarceration. And so there's a lot of movement, activism and enthusiasm and different domains to start to bring attention to a lot of the sort of pathological dependence on sort of of prison expansion and policing to resolve and respond to problems that it is ill-equipped to respond to. And so as it's become, a part of the movement agenda, you're seeing people really start to pressure different levels of government for change, everything from movements to put pressure on local prosecutors that have been previously hard on crime, to now sort of be called to account for those sort of past use of prosecutorial discretion. And you see a sort of influx of new, progressive prosecutors to people, calling for more police transparency and accountability. And, in terms of how those protests are received, I mean, that's sort of, an important set of social scientific questions that, people here in the department as well as around the country are trying to work out those consequences. So how much is moving public opinion and so on, I don't know. But, it's certainly become sort of an energizing force for various kinds of movements to focus on the criminal justice system as a pathway to talk about racial justice, class inequality, and so on.
Thank you. Professor Mink, do you see an increase in students who are concerned about human rights and social justice issues? For the years that I did pre-law advising, I didn't get too many students who cared about those issues.
It's funny you should mention that. A few years ago, actually, right before I came to Mason, I did an interview with a reporter from the Wall Street Journal who's doing a piece on what is called the Trump bump. He had a tremendous increase in the number of law school applicants because people were so disturbed about what he was doing policy-wise, and they really wanted to get into the law. I advise a tremendous number of Hispanic students. One of my favorite students, one of my best students, came here with a coyote from El Salvador. Many of them want to get into immigration law, and for very good reason. So yeah, I do see an increase in certain areas, and I think that's going to continue depending on what happens next in November. We'll see. But strong policy statements from leadership, national and state leadership, have a tremendous impact on students who want to go to law school because they want to change that.
Thanks. We have a question in the box, and I'll give the panel time to read that. So while you're reading that and thinking about your answer, Liam, would you like to tell us about the the 1L experience? What's it like to drink from the fire hose your first year in law school?
Yeah, thanks, Jim. I'm happy to jump in. And sort of to emphasize what Professor Mink said, there really is an asymmetry in supply and demand in the legal field in terms of really where legal services are needed and where people are willing to go. And I think at Yale Law School specifically, and this might not be the case for other institutions, but there is a focus on these human rights and public interest concerns. But a lot of the time people are more oriented to, even within like the public defense or public interest fields, it's places like DC defenders or Bronx defenders, federal defenders, where I'm doing some capital defense work with the Mississippi State Public Defender right now, actually. And Southern states like Mississippi or Alabama, for example, is really where these resources are needed. But even among people who do want to go into the public interest, the demand is not there, or the supply is not there, even though the demand may be. So just that's kind of my brief point on what Professor Mink brought up. But it's been interesting doing law school in a pandemic. We're mostly on Zoom right now, but I think I'm handling it well. We're at the midpoint in the semester, and it's a lot of reading, but I've kind of gotten the ability to prioritize stuff and read what I need to and figure out what's important, gearing up for finals and stuff. But the extracurricular stuff has been great as well. Like I mentioned, I'm doing the capital defense work. I'm on a couple of secondary journals, doing some election protection stuff. So I'm keeping busy. And like I mentioned in my original sort of point on the panel, I think my experiences at Schar kind of prepared me to have a bunch of balls in the air at once on issues like this and do a lot of reading, a lot of research, a lot of writing. So it's definitely been interesting, but I'm handling it well considering the circumstances.
Thank you. Do we have anybody who wants to get a shot at the answering? Jawad asked a question about the international relations. We're looking at, does U.S. policy serve the interests of a few corporations, or does it serve the U.S. national interests more broadly? And certainly he's getting at the notion of contractors. We do know that after the war in Iraq, there were actually more contractors in Iraq than there were U.S. service people. At one point, there were private security corporations that were, in fact, guarding military convoys, which seems like guarding military convoys would be a natural thing for the military to do. And there is a real question of, you know, the interests and the lack of accountability after the shootings in Iraq. There were real questions of, there was no law to apply at the time, that contractors were almost outside of U.S. law and outside of Iraqi law. And a lot of things had to change because the presence of so many contractors really altered the dynamic in Iraq. I know that much. But in terms of corporate interests versus U.S. interests more broadly, that has been a long debated issue. Political scientist named Ted Lowy basically coined the term interest group government, that since the middle 20th century, really with the rise of Roosevelt's New Deal and certainly the Great Society under President Johnson, government has expanded so much and takes on so many duties that it's really interest groups who are negotiating what government does rather than more of a direct engagement with citizens. So there's certainly a literature about that, that people talk about, and certainly people who follow campaigns and elections, one of the more popular things, needless to say, is to follow the money. So we see that in broad interest in terms of how Congress makes policy year in and year out, and we certainly see it in the electoral politics. And there are bits of that, certainly in our private prison discussion. It's about what I know on that. April? April Grayson has said she'd like to answer that, so I'll turn it over to her.
No, she's actually, she was, I think, just moving the question over. So if there's somebody else who would like to field that, maybe if there's, yeah, there's a lot of parts to it. So if there's somebody else who wants to field it, that would be great.
Go ahead. Liam, do you want to go?
Yeah, I was just going to make the brief point that I don't think that it's necessarily a juxtaposition between serving U.S. interests or the interests of a few corporations. And often those two go hand in hand in terms of, you know, natural resource access or geopolitical stability in certain regions that are important to us. The interests of multinational corporations and U.S. foreign policy goals really, really kind of track I think in a lot of places. So I think it's the angle is not necessarily that we're choosing between one or the other, but there really are perverse incentives set up in American society, at least the way that we've been operating over the past 20 years since the global war on terror, that the two do kind of go hand in hand.
And I would just add, if it's okay, you know, the devil is really in the details. And I think Chris really brought up our perceptions of, let's say, prison privatization may be very, very different than the reality on the ground. So I'm going to take a much more mundane example to respond to Jawad, that I look at public pensions. So imagine you have state employees. We're Commonwealth employees, right, at Schar. And when we retire, we're going to have our retirement benefits paid for by the Commonwealth, by the state. Now, there's been a real movement over the last two decades to essentially outsource or privatize some of the management of that large pot of money, which are supposed to represent our retirement benefits, to, let's say, hedge fund managers and private equity partners, and they get paid, and there's that profit motive. And the thinking was that A, part of that investment was going to diversify the larger pot, but B, because there's this profit motive, there must be some efficiencies and you're going to have higher returns as a result. And the reality on the ground hasn't necessarily been that privatization, or really that outsourcing, has worked very well. On the other hand, it's not that the public pot of money that wasn't outsourced did so well either. I think we oftentimes forget that while public servants and managers don't have themselves a profit motive, they're not going to reap any bonuses from a great year, let's say, in the stock market. You know, there is an element of you might have a larger budget for your office next year, and or you might want to leave one day and move to the private sector. And so the individuals doing these private these public jobs are not necessarily working without these private motives as well.
Thank you. We have a new question up, which we have an anonymous attendee says, what are the implications with replacing private police, public police with private security and social services contractors that we need to know about, particularly in the midst of our talk about reimagining policing services?
I can take that, I guess, a little bit. So one thing that people probably don't realize is that the vast majority of police, or at least a majority of police in the United States, are private police. We tend to focus on public police agencies as sort of a target of reform efforts and so on. As we talk about public accountability of police and so on, there is a whole sort of network of private actors that don't have the kinds of restrictions on them that public police have. And so in many cases, what's sort of implied, I think, in the question is right, that sort of the withdrawal of public forms of policing invite, in many cases, less accountable private forms of policing. You know, individual universities, for instance, have become increasingly targets of protest over their use of private police forces. And so this goes, you know, all around the country, all the way to, you know, debates, you know, going on right now at the University of California to, from coast to coast, basically, to right here in the DC area. And, you know, as we're having the conversation about, you know, what's the scope of police authority and what means should we have to hold police accountable, the debate about the sort of larger private actors has largely shifted out of the limelight. And so it's absolutely right that we need to start thinking about what does it mean to hold private policing and private police accountable in the organizations that support them.
Great, thank you very much. I want to go back to May, who's a current student in the Schar School, an undergraduate. May, let's talk about the kind of guidance and advising that you get as a Schar School student, and how you help decide on, you know, your courses, your major, your minor, and what are the other services that, that you have access to, such as internships?
So to start with, I get a lot of help from the advising team of the Schar School of explaining the options and the opportunities that I have in the 4 years that I'm going to be at the Schar School. I am majoring in government and international politics, and I'm concentrating in international relations. That's my focusing field. And I recently declared a minor in Middle Eastern studies. And I'm just interested in that area since I'm from there. The advising that I get from the Schar School is always great. Spring of 2020, I recently got an internship at a nonprofit, and Mason has helped me to get that 6-credit option for, you know, counting it as a credit option class. And it just helped me manage my time between the internship and the class and explaining what I do. That's pretty much it.
We have any more questions? I don't see any more in the question box.
I think Phil was maybe going to answer the question that was posted a minute ago. Phil, were you going to respond to that one?
Well, time has passed, but I will take one shot at what Professor Burke was talking about with the public and private actors in this. Again, I don't want to allude too much to my time in Mississippi, but I grew up in part during the Jim Crow era. Everything in the prison system, the jail system, was controlled by the state in one form or another. I don't think we can be too optimistic about what will necessarily happen if we have, you know, a fewer private actors and more public actors. It really depends. The devil is in the details. It could not have been a more repressive place if you were a Black American to live in that segregated society. Living in those prisons was a terrible, terrible thing. So again, public-private may be important for some considerations, but you don't necessarily get the results you're hoping for just by coming to a public prison.
Thank you, Professor Mink. I overlooked the chat box there. Any comments? Shannon, are we getting close to our end time? Do we?
Yes, we are actually. But if there are any last thoughts that any of the panelists have, or Jim, that you have that you want to share, this would be your time. And if not, I'm hearing silence.
Go
ahead.
I just wanted to first of all thank everybody for attending. And one of the things about the Schar School is we're a multidisciplinary faculty. And Professor Listokin gave you the list of economics and law and political science and organization behavior. We have all of those faculty members together in the Schar School. We have engineers. We just have incredibly diverse faculty. And what that means is when we come to a single topic, such as tonight, we're going to generate a multiplicity of views and insights into that. And that's one of the real advantages. I have never left a faculty discussion where I wasn't feeling enlightened. And many times I just feel like I never even had that thought. Well, that's the advantage of being in the Schar School. Everybody doesn't have exactly the same training. We don't have the same degrees. And therefore, when we're looking at issues of public policy and government, we're going to generate a lot of different viewpoints. You see it in the publications of the faculty, and you get it what's taught in the classroom. So for those of you that are thinking about your options, this is a place where you're not going to get the one size fits all, this is how you think answer. You're going to get, there are so many ways to think about it, and let's talk about what those different ways are to think about it. So it's a really great place to stimulate your thinking, to learn more, and to sort of get into many of these public policy issues in ways that are just robust and full of insights. So I would encourage anybody who's interested to reach out to us, to our advising, or to any of us on the faculty, and we can talk about this some more.
Yeah, and I will say that as a school of policy and government, this moment right now is the moment to be exploring the Schar School. There is so much going on in the next, I mean, there's so much going on all the time, but in the next few weeks, with the run-up to the election, there is a lot going on. There are These first, there's Tuesday discussions every single Tuesday that's facilitated by Steve Perlstein, where he has different folks coming in and talking. And Steve Perlstein, he's an economist and a columnist with the Washington Post, but he's having different topical discussions with leaders in different fields coming in. We are starting in 2 weeks of Friday Power Lunch series, where we're gonna have these really interesting topical discussions with decision makers and leaders and scholars from all kinds of different fields, talking about things like immigration policy and healthcare policy and Middle East politics and US foreign policy and all this different stuff. And that's going on for like two straight months. There are all of these sorts of different events happening in the Schar School. I don't have the Schar School calendar in front of me to post, but if you just go to schar.gmu.edu, you can find the Schar School calendar and come to any of our events. I mean, right now, everything is virtual, everything is open, everything is free. So you have an opportunity to explore more about what's happening politically, what's happening in terms of policies and international relations in the world, the US, and just come chat with other people. So I'm gonna go ahead with that and hand it back to May. But I do wanna say one last thank you to all of our panelists, as well as to all of our attendees for joining us today. It's been, it's a difficult, challenging, interesting topic, and I'm so glad we were able to share this conversation tonight.
Thank you all so much for joining us today. We are more than happy to answer any follow-up questions you have, either by email or by setting up a Zoom call. Send us a note at sharuaa.gmu.edu. We look forward to hearing from you.